The tyrant's heart is a siege of fire and foes. So he is in a hurry. He is a tempestuous heart, strong, violent heart. He exults in the death of things and ruin and fall. Well, this is what happens when the Asuri forces get loosened. There is only death and ruin and fall. He feeds his strength with his own and another's pain. So it is the pain which gives him more and more strength, and the pain of others. In the world's pathos and passion, he takes delight. You are suffering, he enjoys that. His pride, his might, call for the struggle and pain. He glories in the suffering of the flesh and covers the stigmata with the stoic's name. Stigmata, something which is not acceptable. Stigma, infamous thing, something blemish. But here the reference is to Christ's body, stigma on his body. Stigmata is a plural. When Christ was on the cross, he suffered wounds, and many Christian saints had on their bodies those wounds. So they are the stigma on their body. And therefore, stoic, they assume, they accept that things as a holy. He glories. So by accepting, it's not going to solve the problem, you see. You may be a very sage, holy person, stoic person, but ultimately the stigma is there. You cannot remove that. All cover the stigmata with stoic's name. His eyes, blinded and visionless, stare at the sun. The seeker's sight, issuing from his heart, can find no more the light of eternity. Once you have taken the Titan's road, the sight from your eye has gone away, and therefore you cannot get the light of eternity. He sees the beyond as an emptiness of soul and takes his night of a dark infinite. So all that remains is only a void, void of soul. The soul has disappeared totally. He sees the beyond as an emptiness of void of soul. In other words, he has become an extreme materialist. You may be a very religious person and you may have stigma on your body, those marks of suffering on your body which the Savior had come and suffered. You may have those things, or still that's not going to help you. Or you may be an extreme materialist and dismiss the soul altogether. There is nothing like a soul, you can say that. And takes his night for a dark infinite. This is what the materialist will do. His nature magnifies the unreal sublime. Unreal sublime. So, this is what the Titan does. There is no reality, but that itself he will expand, enlarge, see, and sees in not the soul reality. It's nothing but that, it's the soul reality. He would stamp a single figure on the world. So that is the Titan. He would like to put his stamp and possess the entire world. He would stamp a single figure on the world, obsess the world's rumors with a single name. So all that should happen is his name. It is that which should resound everywhere, in all the countries, in all the continents. It is his name they should resolve. His moment center, the vast universe. He sees his little self as very God. That is the extreme of his ego. That is extreme of it. He sees his little self as very God. In other words, the Titan's road is the road of an extreme egoistic person. Possessive. And therefore he says, his little I has swallowed the whole world. His ego is stretched into infinity. His mind a beat in original nothingness. His mind a beat in original nothingness. Shunya. Original. The first nothingness. It is out of that his mind has come. And what does it do? Ciphers his thought on a slate of hourless time. Ciphers means it nullifies everything. It makes it, it reduces everything to zero. Reduces everything to zero. Where? On a slate of hourless time. The time is conceived as a slate. Hourless means without fragmentation, without divisions of time. Hourless would mean without fragmentation, without division. It is on that he has made everything, he has reduced everything to zero. Cipher. This word cipher is a very beautiful word. Of course, I mean, there are two spellings. Sometimes it is C-Y-P-H-E-R, sometimes it is C-I-P-H-E-R, cipher. This word has come from the English word, European word, has come from the Arabic word sifr. S-I-F-R, zero, sifr, sifr, sifr. Sifr has become cipher.
What does mean cipher?
Cipher, zero.
Yeah, but here, what he mean by this? Cipher,
you are
reading
it
to
zero.
He make them zero.
No, see, this is what mind does.
The time becomes zero. Cipher is so.
His mind ciphers his thought.
His mind ciphers his
thought. Makes them.
On a slate of all this time, then what does that mean?
Cipher.
His mind ciphers
his thought.
On the slate of
hourless time.
So what's that?
Basically that it is time is an unbroken continuity.
Yeah.
Unbroken continuity. It is on that as if you are writing something. Writing these words.
Okay.
And it is that thing which has made the whole thing zero. Thought is written on that but has got now reduced to zero. You have wiped off thought, it means. It means basically you have wiped off thought, erased thought, zeroed.
Oh, so he draws everything back.
Yes, everything is drawn back.
Yeah.
It's a very, very, very deep. No, thought is there, but mind has ciphered it, zeroed it.
He made it zero.
Yes.
There is no more zero.
There is no more. Yeah, that's right. Like, he has reduced it to zero.
Takes
yeah.
It out of
existence. Actually.
He makes it. And he draws everything back to barbarism. Yeah, okay. If you look at the third world, right, it's exactly what happened.
See, from
the Nazis,
okay.
Yes.
Yeah.
They wanted to establish a barbaric state in the whole world.
So, Sifra is the Arabic word, and Sifra has come from the Sanskrit. Zero's discovery is a Sanskrit discovery. Sifra, the Sanskrit word is Shubhra. Shubhra. Shubhra means white, pure white, black.
Pure white.
Without any feature, without anything. Without any content, you can't make out anything at all. That is Shunya, that is Shubhra. Shubhra. Total blank, just white everywhere. No color, nothing, no feature, nothing, you see. So Shubhra is the original word from which became Sifra, from which it became Cipher.
Yes.
Shubhra.
And how you say zero in Sanskrit?
Shubhra.
Ah,
no, well, now actually in Sanskrit there are two words. One is Shubhra, okay, and the other one is Shunya.
Shunya.
Zero. Zero. But the etymology of the word Sifra is from Shubhra, white. In fact, for the zero, the origin of the digit zero is the Sanskrit origin, ancient Indian contribution to mathematics. And there they called it Shubhra, they called it Pujya. Pujya means zero. Pujya also means which is worshipped, which is holy. Which is worshipped, which is holy. You see. You offer worship to that Pujya. Pujya. The other one is Shunya. Total blank. Total blank. Contentless. Shunya. So he says, so ciphers his thought on a slate of hourless time. So Narad is really making a very deep mathematical statement, bit of philosophical statement. He builds in a mighty vacancy. Now again, see that cipher, vacancy, nothingness, they're all related. Shunya. He builds on a mighty vacancy of soul, a huge philosophy of nothingness. Shunyavad, what we call it? Shunyavad, the philosophy of nothingness.
Shunyavad.
And he says, of course, philosophy of nothingness. And then, as a part of nothingness, because the soul is not there now anymore, he says, no.
Can we say that Mayavadi,
the
philosophy of Maya is...
Mayavadi is not really Shunyavadi, it is Buddhistic. Basically,
yes,
Buddhistic in that sense. Shunya, that is why he says now Nirvana, he is coming to Nirvana.
Yeah. But
Maya is an illusion, this world is...
Yeah, but then the Buddhism religion is built on nothing.
Nothingness, yeah, Shunya, that's right. Nirvana means all emptying out fully.
So, can we say it is aspiric?
No, no, it's not that. See, it depends upon how you look at Nirvana. Nirvana is to blow out everything.
Yeah, but Nirvana brings you nowhere.
No, you know, what it means basically, in the true spiritual sense, Nirvana means all that which belongs to the inconscience in you, that is removed. You have become totally empty of the inconscient stuff in you. You have become totally empty of that. And then you have attained true nirvana. Because when you have emptied out fully yourself that way, then the true divine can come and enter in you.
So nirvana is not nothing, yes?
It is a positive step towards something for fulfillment. That is why Buddha was an avatar. It is a spiritual necessity to remove all that is inconscient in you so that only the divine can be present.
When you say to remove the inconscient, do you include also the soul? Or only the inconscient?
All that is, soul is not inconscient.
Only the inconscient.
All that belongs to inconscient nature.
Thought.
It is a part of inconscience.
It is a part.
Everything has to go away.
So thought has to go away.
Mental, vital, physical.
Everything has to go away. Actually, Savitri, when she is doing the yoga, she gets a clear instruction. Basically, when Savitri is doing the yoga, she has found her soul. Then she goes into nirvana, the necessity of nirvana. Soul is all right, but what about, means discovery of your soul is okay, is necessary, but that is not sufficient. That is not sufficient. What about your nature? Soul, okay, you have established contact with the divine also has come and sat in your soul. But what about your nature, which is born of inconscience? That is going to trouble you always. And there Savitri is told to enter into nirvana. We will read that part. It's in 128.48. We will read those three sentences. In fact, you read first 128.46. She's told clearly, banish all thought from thee and be God's void. And be God's void.
But that is very difficult.
Shunya. That is the cipher. That is the true cipher.
But that's very difficult. Not to think anything.
Nothing. You don't want that thing. Yeah.
I cannot do this.
Well, then you have to suffer. But Savitri is told clearly. if you cling to your thought, then there is no escape.
Cling to me.
No, you are clinging to thought.
I know.
Yeah. You think that a thought is clinging to you.
20 years I've tried.
No, that's all. At a certain point, that is a necessity. But when the real sadhana progresses, then it has to go away. There is no escape of that. It has to go away. She has been told she must do that. And she says, banish all thought from thee, that be God's void. Not nothing is shunya, not the negative zero, but the positive zero, the shubhra. That is the God's void, shubhra. That is the real God's void, shubhra. The cipher, that is the true cipher. Be God's void, then shalt thou uncover the unknowable, and etc. Let's read this now. Thou shalt be one with God's bare reality and the miraculous world He has become and the diviner miracle still to be. When nature, who is now unconscious God, translucent grows to the eternal light, her seeing is sight, her walk, His steps of power. When she walks, it is He who is walking through her, then you see Him. And life is filled with a spiritual joy, and matter is the spirit's willing bride. Matter is the spirit's willing. Matter has to yield to the will of the Lord. Consent to be nothing and none. Dissolve time's work. Cast off thy mind. Step back from form and name, nama and rupa, remove all that thing, step back. And then he says finally, the injunction is, annul thyself that only God may be. That is the true nirvana. That is the true nirvana. That is the true nirvana. Annul yourself totally, be nothing, 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 that only God be there. And then you will discover your true individuality in God. You cannot discover your true individuality in ignorance, in the inconscience. You discover your true individuality only in God. Therefore, all that is not God's, which is that you have to remove it, you have to blow away, you have to attain that nirvana.
But they are sticking
like,
they are coming back and coming back?
No. It is your true individuality which will come back to you.
No,
no, thought is that they are superficial. But what is behind thought, it is that you will discover. What is behind your mind, it is that you will discover. what is behind your vital feeling. Each has an individuality, each soul has its own character. It is that which will be discovered, and you will find your true expression that way. That is possible only when God is there everywhere. You have to make room fully for God to exist. Until then, otherwise you cling and okay.